The voice of your parents, yes. The voice of your spouse, yes. And the voice of what? Of your circumstances. Your circumstances wants to speak to you. Hallelujah. Please come and give me this other mic. And I told us last week Sunday, I said, from this Sunday, we will begin. We will begin to analyze the voices one after the other. That we will begin to analyze the voices one after the other. We may not take all, but I'll speak on the major ones. One, so that you can know how to manage them very well. Now, in the first service, I'll be speaking on understanding the voice of your mind as a way of securing your future. Understanding the voice of your mind as a way to secure your future. Now, you know why we started preaching this month? You know, this month we started talking about the perfect will of God and that there is what we call a permissive will of God. I showed you last week at the first service that the perfect will of God is what God wants you to do. The permissive will of God is what God permits you to do because you prevail over him. Now, and I said, God might allow you to do what you want to do in order to punish you, even when it is not his will. And the person will say, I got a dream. I heard the voice of God. God said I should go and do it. Now, and you yourself know that it is because you compelled. You insisted that, Lord, no, this is what I want. And we saw from scriptures that God at times can permit us to do what we want to do so as for him to discipline us. So let's start with 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. Understanding the voice of your mind. God can use your mind to speak to you. Now, permit me to start by letting you know that being born again does not mean you should suspend your mind. Now, so many people believe that the moment they are born again, everything they want to do, they must hear it divinely. God, should I eat rice today? God, should I go to Kaduna today? God, should I turn to the right? God, should I sleep on the bed or on the mat? God, should I? God himself is not expecting that we should ask him over everything. Now, God created man to have three images. Number one, man is a spirit. He has a soul. And he lives inside a body. Man is a spirit. He has a soul. He lives in a body. So man is spirit. Man is soul. Man is flesh. Hello. That's why the spirit of man wants to speak to man. The flesh of man wants to speak to man. The soul of man also speaks. That's why your soul is the reasoning aspect of your life. Can we have that scripture? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 23. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. I welcome those of you watching online. Good morning, everyone. God bless you. I read, and the very God of peace, follow this reading, sanctify you wholly. And I pray God, your whole spirit, and soul too, and body be preserved, blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Can you see that man consists of how many things? Three. Man is a spirit, he has a soul, he lives in a body. That's why when the trumpet will sound, it is not this physical body that goes to heaven or hell. Not this physical body goes to heaven or hell. The Bible says, from dust man came, from dust man will return. Now, that scripture is talking to the flesh of man. Now, it says we shall be transformed. If Jesus comes now, the trumpet sound, we pull off this body. Am I communicating? Now, that's why this morning I want you to give me your attention. So I come again. Man consists of a spirit, a soul, and a body. The verse we have just read shows us what we are made of as humans. Each of these components of humans have voice. I told you last week Sunday, your flesh, when it is hungry, you will know. It's speaking to you that I want food. Even when you are fasting and praying and your flesh wants you to eat, it will be speaking. Now, as a man, you see a woman and you are moved, your body is telling you you need to commit fornication. Your body also speaks to you. But next week, Sunday, I'll be teaching you how to conquer the instructions of your flesh. Because if you obey your flesh, if care is not taken, you end up in hell. But today, let's focus on your reasoning. Now, let's go on. Your spirit sees and gets spiritual messages. Some people say, I got a dream. That dream was accurate. God spoke to me through that dream. That's spirit-to-spirit communication. Hello? So that's in the realm of the spirit. Your soul has to do with your mind, your thought life, your reasoning life. Now, that's the aspect of your life that involves calculations. Okay, what do I do now? Imagine you are driving. And there is a vehicle coming, and you are saying, Holy Spirit, where do I drive to? The Holy Spirit will answer you. The Lord is expecting that you what? Reason. That's your thought aspect of life. And that's one of the areas of life that so many Christians today have suspended. Imagine you go to church, and your pastor is telling you you'll be eating grass. Have you not seen it before? And the people go and start eating. Are you a fool? Now, it's a clear sign that you have suspended what? Your reasoning faculty. Your pastor is saying to you, you see, all of you that have come to church, do you want God to make your life better? You say, yes. Now, begin to pack the sand of this place because where we are, it's a holy ground. Be using it to rub your body. You will have eczema. And you see, Christians, is that one ready? Now, and you see Christians do foolish things in the name of what? Because they suspended the function of their mind. That's why you have a soul. The Holy Spirit is not the duty of the Holy Spirit to teach you maths. It's not even the function of the Holy Spirit to teach you in the exam. You now say, I'm going to that exam, I will pass by the Holy Spirit. You will fail by the Holy Spirit too. The Holy Ghost can remind you, but it must be after you must have read. Let's look at the third one. You have your flesh, that's your body, that is also one who speaks to you. So today we are looking at your thought process, and your reasoning. Now, the voice, that's the voice of your mind. So when we are talking about the voice of your mind, we are talking about your thought process and your reasoning. If I look at the lives that so many pastors have destroyed, I've canceled a lot of people. Do you know that some people enter into marriage by the instruction of their pastor? And they are not compatible. It's wrong.
How will pastor just look at you? Imagine somebody say, Emi Olorun gun mi. You, brother, are you married? He said, no. Sister, are you married? Oh yeah, get married in Jesus' name. It doesn't work that way. There have to be a courtship season. Now, and what do we do in courtship season? We use that opportunity to reason. Can we work together? Do we have a future together? Is this the kind of person that, you know, I prayed for one of our brothers in church. She brought the sister to me and said, Papa, please pray us into courtship. You know, I don't join people to say, God, this is God's will. No. I asked him questions. I said, this is sister, I want to get married. And I told them at the courtship season that I'm praying for you to go into courtship, not to have sex. And I want you to know that this courtship that I'm praying you into is not for you to go get married. It is for you to observe yourselves whether this relationship will lead to marriage. Sister, did you hear? He said yes. Brother, did you hear? He said yes. They started their courtship. Now, after like 2 years, they came back to me to break their courtship, that this thing won't work. I now asked the young man, why do you think you can't marry this sister? He said, sir, I have established her in business no less than 4 times. She still keep going back to 0 point. I can't imagine living my life with a burden. So I asked sister, what's it wrong? When I want to establish you, he has established you like 3-4 times. Is it true? He said, yes. What has been happening to the money that I used to establish you? And I talked to the bro. I said, bro, please, can I beg for one thing? Give her 1 more year. 1 more opportunity. Establish her. If the thing break, then decide. So he established her again the 4th time. And at the end of 1 year, she still could not account for anything. Hello? Is it wrong for the brother to break up with that sister? It's not wrong. He made proper use of what? The voice of his mind. That's where so many Christians miss it. You now begin to say, but they say it's the will of God. You don't, when it comes to marriage and certain things, you don't pray with a closed eyes. Hallelujah. We have a lot to learn this morning. I hope you are learning or you are getting angry. Hello. God never intended for us to do away with our mind. Many people stop thinking and reasoning the moment they become born again. Haven't you met Christians that always fit everything? They don't have plan. If you ask them, what do we do? God, we do it. Brother, how about tomorrow? God, we do it. Sister, God, we do it. God, we do it. Now, haven't you seen such Christians eventually suffer? And some of them will begin to blame God. God, you put me in trouble. Jesus was sharing a parable. He said, the kingdom of God is likened unto a man that wants to build a tower. Now, what's a tower? A tower is a very tall building. I know what Jesus said. He said, what is he supposed to do? He's supposed to first sit down and do what? And calculate the cost. It's not that let's just go and lay the foundation by faith. He won't finish it by faith. And it will become a mockery to his faith. The Bible says, let him first sit down and calculate the cost and find out if he will have what it takes to complete it. Then he now said the second parable. He said, the kingdom of God is like unto a man that wants to go to a battle. He said, what should he first do? He said, let him first send somebody, scout, to go out and calculate. The army coming, do I have what it takes to conquer them? It's in your Bible now. Jesus now said, after I must have calculated, if he see that he does not have what it takes to conquer that army, what should he do? He should send delegates to go and apologize. Go and beg. I'm sorry, I won't fight this fight. What do you want? Let us make peace. But today's Christians, I don't know, especially here in Africa, they have so much taught us to the point that we now suspend our reasoning and believe that everything works by miracles. Sir, The cold season we are experiencing now, I told you, weather forecasters told us in June that they noticed that the rotation of the earth is now far from the sun. So in between June, July, and August, there will be extreme cold and there will be pneumonia. Praise the Lord. So people should get prepared. Is it not happening? Is it prophecy? It's not prophecy. That's one of the discovery that was brought out from the use of what? The voice of the mind. Now, that's why it will now become wisdom to so many. That's why you see that. Go to hospitals now. Especially, you see, is it pediatricians or what do you call these children doctors? They will tell you that what is rampant now, you see children with swollen side cheek like this. It's cold. That's what everybody is treating now. You don't suspend the use of your mind because you are born again. Let's go on. They say it is wrong to reason or think wisely over things the moment they are saved. They say spiritual people don't reason things. These have caused a whole lot of disaster today. Some will say, let's just faith on without reasoning. The lack of the use of the mind is what has made several believers to become backward today. I must tell you the truth. Now, what has made the difference in between what we call the developed world and this Africa is because they made use of their mind very fast. Can you imagine? Because we are not making use of our mind here in Africa, we have crude oil. We discover crude oil from our ground. We bring it out. We now take it back to abroad to for them to refine it for us. They will now sell it back to us. Now, don't forget, when they will refine crude oil and bring out diesel. They will refine crude oil and bring out gas. They will refine crude oil and bring out all these insecticides, all these fleets, raid, all those things is from crude oil. They will refine crude oil and bring out polymer. Now, polymer is what we use for the raw material used for plastics. That's where you can sit on the chair. It's from crude oil. Now, you know what? They will now not give us all those materials. So they will sell all those materials to us one by one. They will sell gas separately. They will sell polymer separately. They will kerosene separately. Then this one that plane uses, is it aero, whatsoever. That's why you see that Nigeria is still borrowing. You know why? Because our leaders have suspended the function of the brain. Many years ago, I was making a research. That time, China wanted to boost their economy. You know the first thing they did? They banned importation. They said, everything we are going to be using in China must be made in China. No, they suffered it for a while. Now, and that was what our present president wanted to do when he came in. Okay, let's ban importation of everything. Especially, they started from foodstuffs. Then they went to birds. You don't import chicken anymore. Now, this thing we suffer it for a while, but it will push us into thinking, reasoning, and turn us to a manufacturing economy. Do you know that I got to a point in China, from schools, they were manufacturing things that was being exported. There was one lamp that time. It has radio, it has fluorescent, it has touchlight. Remember that lamp? Wine color, yes. Very popular. When we made research, we discovered that it was the secondary school students in China that manufactured it. Go search all over the world. The people that use their mind will always be served by those who are not using theirs. Go and search all over the world. The people that use their mind productively will always become a boss to those that are not using theirs. Where I am living now, by the grace of God, it was as a result of my wife's thinking. We went to the church site that time. The church was like this. School was built like this. And we're paying rent. They increased my rent from 180 to 350. And my wife, we went to the site. We didn't go to look for where to live in. As we're talking, my wife, I just saw her moving around. And she said, on here. I said, what is that? I said, what is that? He said, I'm seeing something. I said, what are you seeing? He said, can we not live here? I said, where? He said, here, here. I said, this little place. What will this place contain? At least this place is like an extra playing ground. And while she was talking, I caught it. Then I called our engineer, and the engineer came. I said, sir, can we live here? He said, no, sir, we cannot live here because we are thinking of a duplex for you. And I told him my principle, that when the, I have this principle, I want to say it the way I used to say it. When the desired is not available, you convert the available to the desired. That we desire a duplex, yes, but it's not available. What can you do? He now went to draw. He said, sir, we can bring out 3 rooms self-contained out of this place for you. That's where I'm living now. I've been living there for 4 years. If we had suspended the use of our mind, we would have still been giving rent to who? To landlord. Let me tap your neighbor. Say, I command your mind to awake now. You see, Christians, we rather pray for 3 hours and think for 3 minutes. You know what Bishop Oyedepo said many years ago? I had this message. He said, because I know what to do, I pray less. He said, when you know what to do, your prayer time will reduce. Are you learning? Are you sure? Okay, let's do some comparison. Okay, or before comparison, let's talk about the mind. The mind, hear me, is one of the most complex computer in the world today. It is a gift of God from it is a gift from God that you are expected to make constant use of even when you are born again. They become again because of those writings. The mind is one of the most complex computers in the world today. It is a gift from God that you are expected to make constant use of even when you are born again. I wrote here, for instance, you can foresee into the future and avoid silly mistakes if you make proper use of the gift of the mind. I went to bless a land for somebody, one of us, at Adron Homes, along When I got there, I look around. I told the person that took me there, I said I should come and bless the place for him. I said, I was brought to this same place 11 years ago. The owners of this property wanted to sell 1 acre for 260,000 naira. But because of the distance, I wasn't thinking, so if it's now, my bemo. But that time, I didn't know anything about land. They said 260 per acre. If you take like 10, pastor, you can even beat the price to 2 million instead of 2.6. And they were begging. They brought all the documents. You know how much that they bought one plot there now? 4 million. And we have 6 plots in 1 acre. 11 years ago, 260 per acre. Now, 4 million times 6 is 24 million naira. Can you see why reasoners, people that use their mind well, will always be above? That's why you see that some men, we always continue to serve some men. Kishogun, Kishayomo. You know, they will tell some people, the destiny where you carry come, the destiny of suffer. Nobody carry destiny of suffer come. The Bible says, every good and perfect gift is from where? It's from the Lord. We are quiet. What is happening? Hello? I wrote here, learn from the leopards and from the Israelites as they came into a battle against. Now, I will share this one with you. There's no time. We may not open the scriptures. You know, you remember that story when Elisha came to prophesy. There was famine in the land, and a woman had to eat her son, she and her friend. They now went to the man of God. Man of God, what do we do? Man of God said, according to the word of God, by this time tomorrow, there shall be what? Food sold at so and so place in the land. Imagine the man of God determined the price of the food. But how did the prophecy come to pass? Four leopards sat at the entrance of a city. They too were hungry. And the Bible says, these four men said, if we go back to the city, they will kill us. Because the law of Moses says, stone leopards, because they will make you unclean. If we stay here, hunger will kill us. They will kill us if we go. Hunger will kill us if we stay. But if we go to the midst of the Syrians, they might spear us. Look at how they were thinking. First two options, death. The third option that they follow, probably we may not die. Either death or life. And they said, since that one has either death or life, and the two is certainly death, let's go there. If we die, we know that we didn't even have any option. If we go back, it's death, that will die. But if we go there, they might. So if they kill us, we are not going to be disappointed. We're expecting death before. Can you see? If it is today's Christian, what do you think they will be doing? They will join their hands together and they will be praying. Oh Lord, we are hungry. Oh Lord, food. Oh Lord, we are hungry. Oh Lord, food. Oh Lord, we are hungry. Oh Lord, food. That's why I love what Pastor Femi Emmanuel said. He said, we have prayed enough. Now look at the three people presented to us. There are other parties. So Tinubu, Atiku, Peter Obi. Now, look at the three people presented to us. Tinubu is a Muslim. Atiku is a Fulani. Peter Obi is a Catholic. And you know that Catholics cannot go to Pentecostal. Denominational issue. What is now our hope? Now, Pastor Femi Emmanuel said, the reason why it is like that is because we pray a lot. We don't act at all. Now, they told us that all the delegates were cashing money, Abby. You answer me now. Why? Because the people that became delegates that will now produce candidates are not born again. They are businessmen. If all of us now are delegates, I can say, Brother Biola, Magbowo, meeting Tonfe Shilale, to Bagbowo, Yellow Magpayo, Ani Papa Miti Sobe. Iyewa magbowo gbogbo ati mo nto ye ka dibo fun o magbowo. Are you getting what I'm saying? If Iyewa is say ha papa mo pe ma pe daddy Iyewa so fun yawo e ko gbodo gba ko ti e ri wale ko ma fa iku o, at least e beru Olorun abi. But because we are just praying, we are not making any move. These ones are not praying, they are making moves. I listened to Pastor Tunde Bakari about 2 years ago. Pastor Tunde Bakari was preaching on Sunday morning. He said, while all of you are sleeping, 2 years ago, he said, Tinubu is planning on how he's going to become president. 2 years ago's message. He gave the North the chance to rule with a bargain. How many years ago? 7 years ago. That you people rule, I'm coming to take from you. And if you know a typical Awusa man, they are very honest. They keep to their promise. Let's leave politics. Let's come back to it. So look at these leopards. They didn't do like today's Christian. You know, that's why at times I'm very troubled when I see people that are supposed to be in their business places on Tuesday, on Wednesday, they are in churches praying 3 hours. Some pastor will now worsen it. Pastor will now tell them that God is saying you should spend the next 7 days inside the church. And what are you praying for? You are praying for your business. These four leopards, they use their brain. Tell your neighbor, say, use your brain. And when they got to the land of Syria, to that Syrian camp, did they see anybody? The Bible says God has done his own part. What was God's part? God made them to hear a sound of mighty army coming, and they fled. They left everything. Their food, their gold, their dresses. And when these men entered, they went to tell them at the city. Then the prophecy of Elisha came to pass. Do you know why the prophecy of our fathers is not coming to pass? It's because we are not thinking. We are not using our brains. Pastor, we fast and pray and tell you, go and prosper. He has done the praying. You need to get home and begin to think, how do I move my life to the next level? I'll be having a meeting with all our business people, July 27, 11 a.m. All the business, 2 hours. Because some of you, you know what I discovered? What God put in my heart to share with you? Some of you are doing the business that is not an essential commodity. Right now, it is not every business that is prospering. There are some business, for instance, you go to school now and you went to become you went to become I don't want to dishonor any profession. Now, can you imagine? Let me just look at this. Look at this. I won't mention any profession. In the normal setting, doctors are not supposed to prescribe drugs. Description of drugs is supposed to be done by pharmacists. Pharmacists are not supposed to dispense drugs. It is the chemist. Doctors are only supposed to diagnose. What they suspect, they will write to the lab. Those that did laboratory science, take urine sample, blood sample, saliva sample. But what is happening today? Doctor will diagnose. Doctor will prescribe. Doctor will dispense drugs. So gradually the pharmacist is losing out. That's why you now see pharmacists too. If you go to pharmacies today, are they not diagnosing too? They will even inject you. It is the nurse that is supposed to inject. Today, civil engineers, do they have job like before again? Kabiru, that is bricklayer, know how to you tell your Oga. We'll talk that during the business meeting. Right, register that date, July 27th. It's a Wednesday. So these leopards, they use their brain very well. And the Bible says, they entered and brought out testimony. I went to the city and told them. The first time I heard of a thinking room was about 12 years ago. I was listening to Bishop David Oyedepo. He said, I have a thinking room. When I enter that room, all my children, I think I've preached it in church many years ago, all my ministers know that they dare not talk to me. They dare not knock the door. He said, what do I do in that thinking room? There's one chair. There is no television that will distract me in that room. He said, only one chair and rug on the floor. That sit on that chair, I write issues in front of me that I need to think. What do I do about this, 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 and this? From that year, me too, I started, that 12 years ago, it's only that where we are living now, there's no room for extra room. All the places I've lived, ask my wife, there's one special room we left behind for thinking. So these leopards, learn from them. Let's go further. I also talk about another story here. You see that story in Judges. Remember the case when the Benjamite went to rape the concubine of a priest? I've not read it. And they raped her to death. The priest now pieces her body into parts and sent it to the entire tribe of Israel. And everybody got angry. We are going to finish the Benjamites. Benjamin is one tribe, and they had 12 tribes. 11 tribes team up, and God said, go and attack them. They faced the Benjamites. The Benjamites defeated them hands down. They prayed again, God, should we go? God said, go and fight them. They went the second time. The tribe of Benjamin defeated them hands down. The Bible says they now started crying before the Lord. What have we done? Why will one tribe destroy us? God now said to them, when you are going out to fight them, don't face them. Divide yourselves. Strategy. Okay, you have read it. Yeah. Let some of you hide. Let some of you face them. They will defeat you again, oh. As they come out of the city, those of you that are hiding, set the city on fire. When they look back and see that the city is set on fire, they will feel weakened. They will be afraid. Then they will start fleeing. That was how they conquered. Let's just begin. It is in your thinking season, you will discover that, see, you don't have more time. You are growing. What you have strength to do now, you may not have strength to do it in the next 10 years. Can we go on? Let's compare now. Let's do some comparison. What makes man superior to animals? What makes man superior to animals? It is the use of the mind. We have a more developed mind. This makes us know how to deal with animals irrespective of their size and strength. Now, do you know that there is no human being that is as big as the elephant? But we capture elephants and put them in cage. How? There is no human being on earth that is as fast as the leopard. In fact, science discovered that the leopard has the speed of 9 men jammed together. 9. That's why you see that those that run long race, marathon races, are from Kenya, because leopards walk around in the afternoon. So once they see, they begin to run. It was discovered that the lion has the strength of 7 men. Now, why are we able to conquer them? Because our mind is more developed than theirs. That's why we can stay here with a gun, bring down an elephant. That gun, too, that you see, is a product of somebody's what? Thinking. Let's go further. Let's see the difference between men and men. I wrote here, even among humans, those that have not used their minds are inferior to those that have used their mind. The seniority that exists between us is determined by how well. We're watching a film yesterday. And my children, my wife was also in the sitting room, and I was saying, God, please save Nigeria. An astronaut. Astronauts are those that go to the sky, to the moon, to other planets. They went to research. They now had an issue. They left one of their astronauts on the space, on one planet. So they said they have to bring him back. They have to bring him back. We have to bring him back. The whole American nation teamed up. And I told my children a story. I said, do you know that sometimes 2 years ago, Boko Haram captured 4 Americans? Maybe you didn't hear it. You heard it. American army came to Nigeria. Between Chad and Nigeria, they went there and rescued their people. Even Boko Haram used to rescue their own people from our prison. But we don't know how to rescue our people. Imagine, Boko Haram came to Abuja prison, operated for 3 hours, rescued their men. And we have our own people that were captured from the train with them. Now, let's come back to our own story. Let's use our mind. That's why you see that the whites are always ahead. They're always thinking. One of us was sharing with me, he works in a biscuit factory, that biscuit factory in Somal here. He said, Papa, he said, these white people, these Koreans, they have gone far. I said, eh. He said, sir, they no longer depend on our electricity. They produce their own electricity. I said, eh? He said they don't buy fuel from NNPC. No. They source for their own. That's why companies are folding down. Suma is still going up. I got to Afe Babalola University. I saw all their gents switched off. I said, what happened? He said, they got a young man in Nigeria. No, he went abroad to study and came back. He taught them how to generate electricity from waste, from sockerweed. He said, and that's what they've been using. That's why you want to move from DVD, from this big television to flat screen. And you know, flat screen has great. The white people are using their mind to collect money from us. What are you doing with your own? There is nothing that happens until you make it happen. I want you to know that. You have to create time to think. I'm not talking about the thinking of Kilama, jealous, what are you going to eat in the afternoon? You know, that's the thinking that some people know. Let's go on. There's no time. To summarize this, do not send your mind on vacation because you are born again or because you have become a spiritual person. You need a thinking time and a thinking room. I read this story and I want to preach it to you. From this story, I want you to learn. A man went to meet his pastor and said, sir, I've been praying for the will of God in marriage. Sir, what will you have to do about it? Please, I'm praying. I don't know what to do. The pastor now asked him, look at this express road of 8 lanes. Can you cross it with your eyes closed? Holy Spirit, I want to cross. My eyes is closed. Holy Spirit, I hope the car will not knock me down. You will die. Look at when they asked me a question during my wedding anniversary. I told you, the woman I married now, I thank God for her life. I'm not praising her because she's here. I took my time to observe. Number one, she's a child of God. Number two, very hardworking. And that was what they were looking for in the wife for Isaac. Number three, very compassionate. That was where I stopped on the wedding anniversary. But look at the fourth thing I saw. When they gave ring gift to Rebecca, Isaac's wife, what did she do? She took the gift home. It means that she's a family person. Not a person that all her sisters to him, to her, is a witch. Her mother is mama witch. Her daddy is wizard. If I marry that kind of a person, all members will be witch. I wanted somebody that's connected with her family. And I saw it in her. Do you know that when we were dating, my wife would buy cloth. I didn't know. Buy soap and go and give to her mom in my name. When I get to their house, the mom will be saying, Pastor, she gone. God bless you. Thank you. So me, I come out. I'll be asking, what happened? She didn't tell me. But you know, as pastors, I'm used to pretend, you know, pastors, when people greet you, good morning, sir, you pretend as if you know them. Even when you don't know, how are you? God bless you. You know, otherwise people will be offended. So yes, ma. Kotokwema. I'll go. Until one day, she now told me that this is what she has been doing. You don't cross the express with a closed mind. There are certain decisions of your life you don't make without proper reasoning. Quickly, to summarize, how can I make proper use of the voice of my mind? This way I'm really going. All I've been telling you since is just introduction. How can I make proper use of the voice of the mind? I'll just tell you three things. One, the quality of your mind determines the quality of your life. How? Enrich your mind by educating it. Your mind cannot give you the answer you don't have in your heart. Oh. You enrich your mind. Can I tell you the number of books I've read? If you are here, you want to be great, and you have not read this book, The Power of Positive Thinking, one, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, two, I doubt if you are going to be great. Ah, you have not read all these books. Think and Grow Rich. I've read all these books. The 360 Degree Leaders. I've read all these books. You enrich your mind. Your mind is like a store. It's like a library. When there is a problem, it goes to bring the information that you have kept in it. If you have not kept anything, your mind will be telling you, suicide, die. You enrich your mind. You know why you should enrich your mind? You enrich your mind because it will determine the quality of your life. I've been reading books, now, over 28 years ago. The pastor that raised us, that brought us up in Christ, didn't teach us to read books. He will tell you, depend on the Holy Spirit. He eventually ran mad. Oh, yeah, will he last in it? But if I had born in church, I started reading. I've read, in fact, there was one book, you know, this one is not a book, I had to go and get a cassette. I was listening to this man. If I remember his name, I'll tell you. He was not telling me how he became rich. He now put it in 10 cassettes. He called it the Millionaire's Capsule. Do you know I had to go and get the 10 cassettes? I listened to it one after the other. It was from him I now discovered that if you want to become the friend of a millionaire, you must not be a needy person. Millionaires are used to people begging from them. If you are giving to them, they will embrace you. And they will take you to places you least expect. You know, I had those 10 cases I see with me. It's not CD. Cassette. When I had it, I read that. I listened to that tape over 15 years ago. I still have it in my briefcase. That one on top of my wardrobe is still there. That was when I started changing my mindset. That when I see rich people, I should not be thinking of my need first. Because some of you, when you see that, Oma Loti Bole, boy, them has a problem. That's what you're thinking. He came down from Mama, you think of your problem. No. He said, if you want to gain access to rich people's hearts, give them. People that give to them are not common. They don't have plenty of people giving them. Because everybody believes that they have enough. But the actual fact is that there's nobody that doesn't have need. Enrich your mind. Tell your neighbor, enrich your mind. I have 3 minutes more. Enrich your mind. When situation arises, hear me, the library of your mind becomes open for consultation. Show me Matthew 12:34. Look at it clearly. Matthew 12:34. Let's use that to confirm. Matthew 12:34. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. O generation of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? Look at this. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Which means that the heart can harbor abundance. Read. Look for books that will defy you. Read business books. Read health-related books. Read management books. Read books that will make you more matured than your age. I wanted to come with some of my library, my books today, the books I've read. But if I say I should arrange them, I won't find place to arrange them. I read Dr. Lamitoye's book, the man that, the owner of Ibadan Central Hospital, and Academic Suits. That was when I discovered why that man was rich. You know, it was sickness that took him abroad. Then he got abroad. He discovered that Nigerian food was scarce. People were paying heavily to get it. That was where he started. Then he started importing Nigerian, exporting Nigerian food there. He said, whenever I come to Nigeria, he falls sick. When he goes to UK, he's all right. Then he started a restaurant. Then he talked about the Pareto law. You won't know that one. Our business people, Ajomaso, So open your mind to learn ideas that will help you. Read your Bible. Read books that will enrich your mind. Surround yourself with rich-minded people. Not people that have physical riches now. Rich-minded people. I want to say, ti wo gan ba gbo la kaye le lenu mo e iwo e gan ba e ah la kaye nbe nbe. Surround yourself with such people. It will make you fly. See here. Number two, how can I make proper use of the voice of the mind? Number two, spend quality time thinking before making moves. Don't make moves when you have not taken time to think. Don't speak before you think. Don't speak and think later. You might regret it. Don't just only pray. Thinking time is preparation time, and it should be longer. I said, MC, God will honor you. Those days when she was battling with the growth of the school, I wake up at night, I'll see my wife on the bed. What are you doing? I'm thinking of one or two things. You just say that she will go to school the second day, she will implement, and she will come back. When I ask her, how did you do it? In fact, I was just thinking of this, and results will show. That's how it's supposed to be. Ki kan se pe a o sun kan ji ah a fe lo jani la ro la ijani ijanla la o funi ja o so le emura ogun ajele emura ogun jesu lo lori ogun jesu le ti ko leyin e because he wants you to listen. Now lastly, because of time, always present the outcome of your productive analysis before the Lord in the place of prayer. Now, that's where some people also miss it. After you have now finished thinking, you've gotten a decision, pray about that decision. Are you getting me? So that it will not be as if you are just depending on your mind. After David finished thinking, he said, give me the effort. They now brought the effort. He said, Lord, shall I pursue? Will I overthink? Will I recover all? That was the conclusion of his mind. Shall I pursue? Don't just think, get a conclusion and start. After you have thought over it, you have enriched your mind, you've gotten a conclusion, now put that conclusion where? Before the Lord. Are you blessed this morning? This is one of the ways by which you can secure your future. The human mind is an elastic. It has the capacity to go beyond expectation. I'm closing now. I rest my case this morning. If you want to clap, you better clap. So everybody, I expect you to go and have your thinking room from today. If you live in a room, have a thinking corner. You know, in those days, we used to watch one comedy. What's the name of this one? The man that said, you have a thinking cap. I think it's Papa Jasko comedy. There's Alinko that has a thinking. He said, I'm putting on my thinking cap. I want to think. It's gateway to the thought. Let's rise up. Let's rise up. We have